I know you've made a discovery. Have you memorized the three numbers?
I haven't.
You don't know them?
I don't know them, sorry. No. In fact, I didn't even notice. I learned from somebody else's posting that one of the numbers is prime. So I hadn't noticed that. We found three integers whose cubes sum to 33. This number was immortalized in a paper by Bjorn Pudin. He pointed out that if you want to solve that problem for the number 29, it's really easy. So 29 is 27 plus 1 plus 1. If you move a bit up the number line and you ask about 30, we know a solution for that, but the numbers are in the billions. And that was only discovered in 1999.
And Andrew, as I understand, there are some numbers that you will never find one for.
That's right. So if your number, if you divide it by 9 and you get a remainder of 4 or 5, then we know you can't do it. And so you made a brilliant video with Tim Browning on this. At the time, it was an unsolved problem.
There have been some attempts to prove that this number isn't on the list, but those attempts have failed.
And, well, I've just solved it. I first saw the video, you know, around the time that it came out, and I thought a bit about it, but didn't get very far. It was actually the follow-up video on 74. I think that was made a couple of years ago, but I only saw it last month, and that spurred me to think more about it, and I got hooked.
That this last number here, 74, is actually represented as a sum of three cubes.
Maybe I'll show you something about these numbers. So I've got Sanders' paper here. So if you look at the end of the paper, he's put all of the numbers below 1,000 for which we don't know the answer. Now, here's a test, Brady. Do you notice anything about these numbers peculiar?
No, I can't. I'm not seeing it.
Okay, if you stare at it a while, you might notice that they're all divisible by 3. Okay, and if we take this a step further and divide them by 9, actually, this is a good plug for your casting out 9s video. Okay, so this one has remainder 6 when you divide it by 9. This is another 6, another 6. Starting to see a pattern here. It breaks with this one. This is remainder 3. Okay, this is remainder 3, this is remainder 3, and so on and so forth. So it turns out they all have remainder 3 or 6 when you divide them by 9. That's not an accident. So as Tim explained in one of the follow-up videos, you know, it matters what the remainder is when you divide by 9. We know that if you get remainder 4 or 5, then actually there's no solutions at all. The same kind of analysis shows that if you get remainder 3 or 6, it's possible, but only just. It means the solutions for these numbers are likely to be more sparse, okay? And that's what ends up making them hard to find. The modern conjecture is that every one of these numbers, there'll be infinitely many solutions. It's just they're extremely sparse, and so, you know, the first one can be enormous, as we've seen. We want to solve an equation like x cubed plus y cubed plus z cubed equals, say, 33. And we're looking for solutions where all of the numbers are below some bound, okay? So, say, absolute value of x, absolute value of y, and absolute value of z are all below some bounds, say, b. Okay, so imagine b is a million or something. Now, on the face of it, this is a three-dimensional problem. Okay, we've got three variables to solve for, x, y, and z. And if you just went through all possibilities up to b, that's somewhere on the order of b cubed numbers to check. I said you can imagine b is a million. To put things in perspective, your smartphone can do a million things in the blink of an eye, a million calculations like this. Okay, but if I say a million cubed, all right, that's in the realm of possible but very expensive. To do on modern computers. So this is actually very wasteful. So it's not hard to see that in this search range, there's loads of places where there's no point in looking. Okay, so if I imagine that x, y, and z are all positive and large, then of course there's no way that the sum of their cubes is going to be a small number. Okay, so already there's big parts of the search range that you can cut out. If you take this idea to its logical conclusion, it's not hard to see how to get from b cubed down to b squared. This was realized pretty early on. Even the very first computer investigations that people did in the 50s on this, they had algorithms that were basically quadratic. It would work in this time. Now, that wasn't improved on for about 40 years. And then a guy called Noam Elkies at Harvard, actually in a newsgroup posting, he proposed another algorithm, which is pretty amazing, actually. It manages to get down from b squared to basically b to the 1 power, so b to the 1 plus something very small. And it's basically what enables us to go to the ranges that we are today, you know, 10 to the 15, 10 to the 16. So it turns out that Elkies's algorithm is most efficient when you're looking for solutions for lots of numbers, as we were for a while. But you can see we're getting down to a pretty short list at this point. So I started to think, well, maybe there are other approaches that we could look at. My approach uses more algebra. So what I'll do is I'll take this equation and then we'll move the z cubed over to the other side. Okay, so that gives us x cubed plus y cubed equals 33 minus z cubed. This is now x plus y, x squared minus xy plus y squared equals 33 minus z cubed. Okay, now why have I done that? Well, we have this factor that that we know is there. Okay, I'm going to give this a name. I'm going to call it D, say for divisor. All right, now one more step, and I promise we're getting to the end of the algebra. Let's divide both sides by D. Okay, so I'm going to have on the left side just x squared minus xy plus y squared. On the right side, 33 minus z cubed over D. Now, it probably looks like I've made things a lot more complicated, right? We started with three variables, and now we've got four. But I want you to imagine for a moment that we know the values of z and of d, or maybe we have some guess for them. Well, that means that everything on the right-hand side is something I know or I can compute. On the left-hand side, I have a quadratic equation with two unknowns. Now, as everybody knows, if you've got two variables to solve for, you need two equations. I've got one here, but there's another one that I used implicitly but didn't write down, and that's this one. So x plus y is equal to d. All right, so now I've got two equations, two unknowns. We know how to solve this. Or more to the point, if I guess values for z and d, I can tell pretty easily whether there are corresponding integer values of x and y. Okay, and this is the idea. We just go through all possible values for z and d and see if there's any corresponding x and y. Now that, again, sounds like it should be something like b squared, right? Because there's two variables. But the key is, once I've picked a value for z, the values for d are actually quite restricted because they have to be divisors of this number 33 minus z cubed. And there aren't many of those. So once you've worked out z, you can work out all the possible values for d pretty easily and then just try all of them. I've glossed over a few things here. So in actual practice, you do it the other way around. You go through values of d and then you work out z from there. But this is the idea in a nutshell. So I use lots of computers. Actually, there are a few separate clusters. And the computation that found the solution was the big computer at the University of Bristol, Blue Crystal Phase 3. This happened way faster than I was expecting. So I started this. I thought I was in for 6 months of computation. My initial fear was that nothing would turn up and then I'd have to justify why I was using so many CPU cycles. Okay. As soon as I started using the computer, within a few days, it found the solution. The bound I used was 10 to the 16. So that's 1 followed by 16 zeros. I had actually planned to do 10 to the 17. Okay, but one popped out before I expected it. You'll see here at 9:05 in the morning on February 27th. So this was running on 512 CPU cores at the same time. One of them went through one of these values of D. Actually, this is the number D in the middle here. I don't know what that is, 87 trillion something. Okay, it turns out to be a prime number. From that, it did all of this algebra and it found the corresponding values of X, Y, and Z, and here they are. Now, the computer found the solution at 9:05, which is just after I dropped my kids off at school and as I was walking to the university. And I noticed it around 9:30 when I got to my office.
Was there an email or?
No, I didn't rig it to send me an email, so I had to check. It makes it more fun because there's an element of uncertainty in the thing.
How often were you checking? Were you already checking like every hour or do you check once a day?
Once a day or something like that. Yeah. As soon as I saw the file was there, I knew that it had a solution. Of course, then I checked it. You're never 100% sure that you haven't made a mistake somewhere. So I put these numbers into the computer, cubed them and added them up and about 33.
What did that feel like?
I did a jump for joy, yeah.
Literally?
Yes. You made an excellent point in the first video on this, which is that we can't hope to solve this by just computing more, okay? Because there's always another number. For us, the next one is 42.
So 42 is the new white whale, is it?
42 is the new 33, yeah, that's right. So if we just look at the numbers up to 100, so let me say k less than or equal to 100, there's 22 numbers in that range that give a remainder of 4 or 5 when you divide by 9.
So they're impossible.
So they're not possible, that's right. We know the answer for those, and they're not possible. That leaves 78 numbers to account for. The very first computer investigation of this was done way back in 1954. That's pretty early as these things go. And they found 69, solutions for 69 out of the 78. Well, of course, that's not the end of the story. So computer technology advanced rapidly from there. And within a decade, another group of mathematicians ran it on a bigger computer. But they were disappointed because they found only one more, despite going about 20 times further in terms of the variables. But remember, they were using a quadratic time algorithm, so it's about 400 times as much work. So it's impressive from an engineering standpoint. Yet they found only one more solution. So they took this as evidence that there probably aren't any more. They hedged their bets a little bit. They didn't say no more solutions, but they said that not all of the remaining eight candidates would have solutions. That was the prevailing wisdom for a while, for over 20 years. Now we think that conjecture is wrong. Okay, things have kind of turned around. But it wasn't until the early 90s that Heath Brown said, well, hang on, so if there are solutions, they're likely to be extremely sparse. In fact, he does some calculations, and he shows that for some of these small numbers, you would expect the numbers from one solution to the next to increase by a factor of millions. Okay, so that means, you know, each time you find one, you're going to have to work a million times harder to find the next one. So the fact that you've expanded the search range by 20 and not found anything is not by itself very good evidence that there's nothing more to be found. And so people looked again from 1991 to this year, 2019. We found solutions for 7 out of the 8. There's only one number left. 42 is the only one left below 100. So we have not completely disproved their conjecture from 63, but it's looking pretty good for Heath Brown's counter conjecture.
Andrew, have you got the computer looking for 42 now?
I already looked for 42 in the same range and nothing turned up. But yeah, maybe we shouldn't stop there.
So to find 42, you've got to go bigger.
That's right. Yeah. There's a definite purpose here because this is a problem where we're not even sure, or it's not even obvious what the right conjecture should be. Okay. And that's evidenced by the fact that the conjecture's changed in our lifetimes.
Does that mean, you know, a mathematician like you, instead of just picking them off one by one with a computer, should you be sitting down and trying to come up with a rigorous proof? I mean, what's the point of just picking these off one at a time?
Yeah, well, so, of course, other people are working on that sort of thing. And we do have theoretical evidence that supports the conjecture, too. Some people think, though, that this problem is actually undecidable. So it might be that we never have a proof, and this is as close as we can come. Okay, so but with each one of these stubborn candidates that we find, that gives another nail in the coffin of this idea that there aren't any more solutions.
So, in a way, knocking off these stubborn candidates, I've never heard that term before, I like it. Knocking off these stubborn candidates is almost you're giving hope to the people who are actually trying to come up with the rigorous proof.
Yeah. So it's looking pretty good for Heath Brown's conjecture. So probably this conjecture is true, and we can ask, you know, can we prove it?
What's that conjecture in a nutshell? What is the conjecture?
So every one of these numbers that doesn't have remainder 4 or 5 when you divide it by 9 will have infinitely many solutions, infinitely many ways of writing it as a sum of 3 cubes.
Did you tell your family about this? Did you tell your wife?
Yes.
What'd she say?
She was wondering why she should care, yeah. I think. So I even told the children, and they were excited. And I run a maths club in my kids' primary school. And we did a unit on cubes and adding up cubes and talking about this. I showed your video. Even.
What are you going to do with this number? Are you going to get it tattooed on your arm or anything?
No, as you saw, I don't even remember it. But
you have to memorize it. That would be a good party trick. All right. Next time I come, I want you to have memorized it.
All right.
I'm going to come back to these ones. But the next eligible one is this number 33. And in fact, we still don't know an answer to that one. So we've not yet been able to find any integers which, when you sum their cubes, you get 33.